I've been thinking a little differently lately. I'ma tell you the truth and they gon' say things, but you gon' hear me coming either way. If I put my mind to it, little buddy, you know I'ma do it all the way. Roaches hate, I'm making moves, I listen about as much as I can tolerate. From here on out, we cutting out the people who don't contribute to winning. Raise a glass to everybody who was here from the fucking beginning. I'ma tell you the truth and they gon' say things.
Ei, hai tu calaccio. Vai, Sweet Princess Silk.
If I put my mind to it, little buddy, you know I'ma do it all the way. Roaches hate, I'm making moves, I listen about as much as I can tolerate. From here on out, we cutting out the people who don't contribute to winning.
Yet I am not finished yet. I have more to say. I just feel like pushing in the field a few more. Let me develop, but I just, as I usually do, and that's how you have to go about anything. If you don't really know about something, start with what you do know and see what else is there, if there is at all anything else. Beba being the pawn. No, RT Tinkler doesn't really count. Now you have to listen to all the videos from today about the subject. About La Beba. The issue is this. As I was told by, I don't know whomever not, but it seemed like it was a general thing in the choir of Bellas Artes in Mexico City that La Beba, who was the pianist, now took off her shirt, her pants, and put on mini skirts as she saw Fernando de la Mora walk in and rehearse. Like she had a knack for him and she married him. It seemed like the periodif. It seemed like downsizing, downgrading her, that commentary. I'm not sure if you caught that in my voice. No, I had to make I had to make it clear in my head. It was like they were laughing about her. Ha 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 ha. What about? I don't know. I didn't know her. I just heard the commentary. But the issue is this. Now she looked like a boy. Yeah. Short hair, no makeup, and from the north. Those are not like, they don't, yeah, die drehen nicht um den heißen Brei. They don't beat around the bush. From the north. And I like people from the north. Yeah, well, the dummy doesn't include. Yeah, Mr. Tosto Bobonita, I don't include him. But my very first girlfriend, as I arrived to Mexico, was from the north. I never ever talked to her, you about her. Yeah, like 2 times I saw her, maybe 3, that was it. She was also political engaged, and then I noticed in which she ceased being my girlfriend. It's a longer story. Let me not go there, but I will if you want. Her name is Gabriela. And her sister, who was large and she wasn't, her name is Erendira. And that name, that got from 100 Years of Solitude, Gabriel Garcia Marquez, that book. Okay, those are the ways. The ways. I arrived to Mexico and those wanted to be emancipated. So Gabriela aimed for politics. Unfortunately for El PRI and not Pierre D. So as I noticed that and what it meant, I kind of wasn't interested any longer or something. And her younger sister, who was tall and large, she was a little bit of a dummy, man. But she married an English teacher. Yeah, some American person. Also weird. It seems more like opportunistic, the whole idea. Very short-lived. But she was like the first person I actually met more than once when I arrived in Mexico, Gabriela. And they talked to each other like they wanted to be now emancipated in Mexico as women. And they talked to each other with the name Way. That may be translated as dude, but it's worse. Because Way, only men say it. And it's not very educated. So not calling each other dude, that doesn't really, not that lancho, it doesn't really make the trick, that translation, but there isn't really no such in American English. Wait, like now they're dudes. That was weird. No, of course I did not chime in. If I don't understand, I don't say, never did. I don't say weird and bad words, which I don't understand. And when I understand them, even less so, I say those. I am delicate and I am princess. I look at things. So I would never say that. I think it's completely inappropriate. There's different ways of emancipation. So let me go back. La Beba, from the north, looking like a dude in a way. She was slim. She wasn't ugly at all. And straightforward. To me, she actually depicted herself as, in my world, if I give all the values and I make a sum, oh, that's a cool person. No makeup, cool. Short hair, cool. Slim, yeah, whatever. That's also good, whatever. And straightforward, cool. And she plays the piano, cool. So everything cool about her. Big deal. And she smiled. Well, Mexicans do smile. I don't know how well she played the piano. I don't know if she ever accompanied a concert. I don't know any about it. So, which is interesting because all her little cizaña, her little mischievous actions completely did not roll off my back. I wasn't even aware. I never made all these connections that I had to start lessons at 10 the second year. That had anything to do with anything, with her and me and whatnot. Or that her sister started to boycott me with the food. That had to do with La Beba too. Or the sisters made like an alliance or whatnot. I never really understood any of it. It was not part of my register. I was absolutely unaware. Oh, Achichincle was just another pianist. Yeah, it doesn't matter to me. Totally unrelated. He looked just like anybody else. I had nothing for or against any of them. So I did not make that very clear today, right? Okay, so the first opera workshop in Mexico City initiated the CIVAM era in Mexico. And that was like many weeks and teachers came and many students were there. I was a listener. And many years later, a few years later, two other workshops happened where I was in Saltillo, shorter. And less teachers, of course. Also, less students. So I attended two of the workshops in Saltillo. No, not as a listener, as a student. No. And I had not noticed how gossipy the world of opera is. I mean, like, nationally. Or internationally. I had not noticed that. Oh my God, there's more to say. Well, eventually I figured that the people who were always in groups studying like at the conservatorium, they were like competing with each other. But I wasn't part of them. And yeah, of course, I saw they have the advantage that they continuously need to sing in front of other singers. And I didn't have that practice ever. When I started singing in public, nobody had ever heard me because I had no one to sing to. And that idea, I sing in front of everyone, that came a little bit, I mean, the idea was there, but the practice was later. Because in order to feel safe to sing in front of an audience when you just start, the best thing is that you actually sing in front of an audience as often, as many times as you may. So I took that on. Anytime, anywhere, I would just sing. Anywhere. Yeah. Almost in the elevator, man. I sang in a tiny yacht in a sailboat for three. I sang in an entrance of a lobby in New York in some apartment for the apartment building for the, I don't know, concierge. I sing anywhere. I sing in front of anybody anywhere. All the time. One aria maybe. That's all. Sometimes more. Sometimes not. Depends on the environment. Yet I hadn't sang yet. And I thought those always sing and they don't feel that intimidated because it is intimidating in the very beginning. So in hindsight, looking at the greater perspective, okay, more gossip. Later, I met Daniel Catan. No, I had met him right there when the first opera workshop took place. Daniel Catan, like the only Latin American composer whose opera was actually presented more than once in an opera house in the United States. And he talked to me about the gossip of internationality. And also the coaches said so. Okay, the coaches said, if you do one thing wrong and it's unprofessional, the entire opera world will know it in no time. And Daniel Catan made it more explicit. He said, I just went recently to the States, and as I was being picked up by one of those fans of the opera world, who would host, of course, her car and maybe her house even to overnight there or sleep there, yeah, rich people maybe, or semi-rich, or wannabe. So she asked me about my divorce. That's what Daniel Cantan told me. And he said, wow. He said, I was flabbergasted because it just had happened like the night before or so. That who on good Lord's earth would bring the news and travel in the internet to the entire opera world and know about knowing about my private life. Get it? So he explained, that's what he made explicit, how gossipy this all is. Yeah, on the personal level and on a professional level. So you have to be very careful when you go audition anywhere, because there are certain things you just can't allow yourself because you're off. You're never going to get on stage again. It is that scary. So in hindsight, now thinking about 1 year I go to Saltillo, I'm a mezzo-soprano, and I barely sing. The next year I go to Saltillo, now I'm a soprano. And 3 months later, I have the largest concert in Cuernavaca as a soloist. And then look at the repertoire. Obviously, no one had named it yet, Spinto. Do you know how rare Spintos are? No one had ever met one. Spinto stands for, you know it, soprano and mezzo-soprano can sing both.
When the rain hits my window, I take it, me some, me and Timberland, we sang a dango. We so tight that you get our styles tangled. Sway your do-si-do like you loco. Can we get kinky tonight like Coco? Can we get kinky tonight like Coco? Can we get kinky tonight? Can we get kinky can like Coco, like Coco, like can we get